Okay, yes. So what I'm trying to say that when it comes to Putin's elections, he was above this mundane event. Now, United States elections were not a kettle of fish, because it was after his meddling that Mr. Putin's activities were finally noticed, and partly because of domestic US considerations, and perhaps actually he was noticed more than he would deserve, because the rules of game changed for him. There were sanctions, there were repercussions, there was a lot of limelight. And one could have expected Putin to scale down, to downsize. So let us look at what we got after the elections. We've got Skripal poisoning, we've got a Azov offensive, where 200 Russians were killed in direct contact with the United States troops, and we've got a promise to sink their ships in the case they attack Assad, which was not carried out. And taking at face value, this is clear escalation. And let us look more carefully at the details. So first of all, let us consider Skripal case. And my best guess is that we are dealing actually with a botched assassination attempt. Because those who did not, those behind the act, they did not want to poison U.S. Skripal. Their sole target was Sergei Skripal. Of course, it is dangerous to speculate in the absence of details. But consider this. Suppose that Sergei Skripal, 66, has been found dead in his home. He would have, his death would have been attributed to a heart attack, the symptoms are the same, and speculation of who would have been right. All Russian would-be betrayers would have been horrified and supremely warned off. The British authorities would have been understandably unhappy and suspicious as hell, but they wouldn't have been able to do much, especially if the relatives claimed the body. I can, for instance, say that there was another thing that, in my mind, was an assassination, a successful assassination attempt, and this is the death of Mr. Perepodichny. And actually, after an attack on me, which was, of course, not in any way similar to the one that happened to Mr. Skripal, to Mr. Litvinenko, and I was talking to a British ambassador, and I was asking him pointed questions about Perepodichny attack, and he hand-in-hand, and I could see that his heart was not in it. Putin would have been triumphant. The death of a traitor would have pandered to his ego and one more demonstrated to him his apparent invulnerability and the weakness of a civilized world, which can stand up to the challenge of alpha male. So basically, as I've said, this is just my conjecture. But to me, Skripal's poisoning is essentially a failed operation, not because both victims are alive, but because it became very public. And in this, it resembles Litvinenko case, because Litvinenko case, in my mind, also was not destined to be public. That is, it was destined to be public in the sense that everybody would have been asked, what happened to this traitor? He is dead. But nobody would have understood how. Because it's very funny, maybe I digress here, but what happened to Litvinenko, the usual question is, the big question, why polonium 210? Why not make him a victim of money? And actually there's a paper, a Russian scientific paper, that answers this, and it was written back in the year 1980s, and it said that polonium is untraceable. So basically my contention is that these guys in FSB, they read this paper, it was written back, as I said, in 1980s, and they just sort of forgot that some time has passed. So they wanted to make it out as an incomprehensible death. And instead, actually, they left their traces all over the places they shouldn't have been left. So, of course, what I'm saying is that it has one downside. It means that there were several successful operations carried out. Perhaps not many as BuzzFeed contends, because they say there are 14 deaths killed by Mr. Putin. Well, I think that's an exaggeration. I think that's tabloid. But, of course, cases like Perepodichny, cases perhaps like Mr. Stephen Curtis, if you are FSB, you're not making mistakes always. You're making them sometimes. But coming back to Skripal, So what I'm trying to say that there was no idea of whipping up patriotic fever, no dotted, you know, it was just a coincidence that this happened before the elections. And the main problem, what we really see in this assassination attempt, is unprofessionalism and degradation and corruption. Because the current state of Russian Secret Service, it seems it's just not up to the task of carrying out spectacular but improbable assassinations, at least doing it at least once without any state. Now let us move to another case, that is Deir Azor. And that's February 8 and 9, around 200 Russians who were killed at Deir Azor in the course of US airstrike. And mostly they belong to the so-called Wagner Brigade, sponsored by the Kremlin cook Mr. Prigozhin, the same one that is responsible for Facebook trolls. Mr. Prigozhin casts a shadow figure in Russian regime, and maybe I'll speak of him a little bit later. And actually it's official now, because on April 12th, Mike Pompeo told the Senate that a couple of hundred Russians were killed in Syria by US warplanes. And this was actually the first direct confrontation between Russians and US troops since the Vietnam War. So the big question, was it intentional? On the one hand, we can clearly see that Putin bears an umbrella responsibility. He made a deal with Mr. Erdogan for partitioning of Syria, and actually this can be a coincidence that Wagner attacked Kurds at Deir Azor at the same time Mr. Erdogan was attacking these very Kurds in Afrin. This was two pincers. This was a double strike at Kurds. But on the other hand, let us consider the evidence published by the Washington Post in February 25. And the Washington Post said two very specific things. First, it said that Prigozhin was talking on phone to the Syrian minister, who assured Prigozhin that he will be paid. Secondly, Mr. Prigozhin tried to reach Vladimir Astrovenko, who is a deputy to Mr. Weiner. This is chief of staff to Mr. Putin. Look, this is a very roundabout way of planning a military operation. A president's cook calling a civilian deputy chief of staff. It looks, you know, a little bit crazy to me. And how did I try to read this? Maybe I'm also wrong, but what I'm making of it? That Mr. Prigozhin, he has got a sort of umbrella permission. Then he was promised money or oil by Syrians, and he's planning an operation. And he gets a go-ahead from Russian Minister of Defense, that is Sergei Shoigu. And then he calls this deputy chief of staff, because at this time he has no direct access to Mr. Putin. And he wants to, as we say in Russian, prolozhitsya, safeguard himself, a typically Russian word. Why? Because, you know, he knows that Shoigu hates his guts. This is true. Shoigu hates Prigozhin's guts because, you know, basically every sensible military commander, however inept he is, however incompetent he is, he will hate a private operator who encroaches upon his ground, upon his feeding ground. So in the case the operation goes south, Mr. Prigozhin wanted Putin to know that he was authorized to do the operation, and so that Shoigu will not attribute the failure entirely to Mr. Prigozhin. So basically, this boils down to the fact that Mr. Putin did not know that Russian volunteers, will attack United States forces. And you'll say, how come? Because, well, it's a big story, it's a veil of an event, a real military confrontation between United States and Russia. And, of course, there's just one word to explain it, or rather two words, plausible deniability. That's the key to understanding Putin's strategy, because my predecessor saw that Putin is outsourcing. It's not exactly outsourcing, because Putin is not thinking in terms of war. He's rather thinking in terms of black ops. He's always ascribing it to volunteers, to shakhtyori and traktoristi, as he put it when he was talking about Ukraine. He may technically...
Coal miners and truck drivers.
I'm so sorry, because, yes. So the truck drivers, as you know, some of these truck drivers were very adept, or rather inept, in using a Buk missile system to shoot down a Malaysian airplane. Tractor drivers for you. What is basically Putin's contention is that he didn't attack US troops. Well, oops, it was a private military. And of course it's sad, because look at Putin. He's the guy who tries to control everything. He controlled Russian television. He controlled Russian oil. He controlled Russian gas. He controls whatnot. He tries to control internet right now to shut down Telegram, whatever. Are we to believe that the guy who controls, I don't know, how do we make meatballs, is not going to control a private military company? Because, you know, there are no real private armed forces in a modern state. Because we are no feudal Europe. It's no Achaemenian Persia, where satraps and dukes, they wage war against each other. And this is precisely why Putin is doing it. Because the minute you have a private army, the head of this army, this is, on the one hand, there's a plausible deniability. And on the other hand, there's a downside. Because the head of this army, the minute it is created, he gets his goals that may not coincide with yours. He will attack United States army because he's promised something by the Syrians. This is a great problem for Mr. Putin. Because on the one hand, he wants the possibility of denial. It's not me. On the one hand, this is precisely something that gets him in trouble. Because the minute you delegate the authority, especially military authority, you lose a part of it. And now let us consider this third case, and that's the poisonous. And actually, I think I missed. Yes. I was. Let us take the third case. Poisonous gas attack in Ghouta and Putin who defends Mr. Assad. Now let us ask this simple question. Did Putin know about the impending gas attack? And my answer is probably no. There was no reason to lofty Mr. Putin to bother himself with these mundane details. So what was Putin's reaction? It seems paradoxical because just recently there was a direct hit on Russians. He didn't even bother to acknowledge what happened a day or so, let alone to act. There was no direct official confirmation of losses. But when the United States announced the strike against Assad, Russian propaganda machine just ran amok. It was a very strong contrast. There were 200 Russians killed and not a peep. And there were US airstrikes, and there was live coverage on all Russian TV channels. So what is the difference? The difference is, of course, publicity, PR. Putin didn't care a dime how many Russians died. What he did care about was his public image. He said that Assad is under Russian protection, so the US strike is a public assault on Mr. Putin's authority. So basically this means, boils down to the fact that he wanted Mr. Assad to be his proxy. And instead, Mr. Putin became Mr. Assad's hostage. Because, how did Kremlin cope with this thing? Simplicity itself, I don't know whether you know it or not, but first there were highly publicized words of a Russian ambassador. His name was Zasypkin, and he said that in the case of the strike, Russians would sink the United States ships. Then there was, as I said, this live coverage, 24 hours for seven. Then there was a ludicrous claim that was the best one. Russian general staff, no less, that claimed that they shoot down 70 rockets out of 100 American rockets, which is basically bullshit. But it was not. No, but
I recall telling that to Mr. Putin one time.
Look, but the fantastic thing is that it was done by general staff, not by some crazy TV presenter. And of course, this presented to Russian public a convincing picture of Russian might, but actually it was not only pure PR. There is an important thing that it tells us about Mr. Putin. It tells us that he's basically unwilling to engage United States in an open military confrontation. He does not want a short victorious war, because he knows that the war will be neither short nor victorious. And what he does want is to seem to wage a war. He wants all the benefits of the war without its losses. He wants a PR war. And it's the same thing with Kripatz. He wanted everybody to be impressed and terrified without a ground to react upon. I'm not here to judge these girls on moral or strategic grounds. And actually, it's the same thing with these Russian rockets that fly to Florida. It's all on TV. He wanted to be able to show that he's able to destroy Florida actually without lifting a finger. And I'm trying to say that this means that the means Putin is using are incompatible with the goals he wants to attain. And this is actually the main fuel driving the confrontation. He did not want to be caught poisoning Skripal. He did not want to engage United States directly at Deir ez-Zor. He doesn't care flying, well, fig, above Prigozhin, getting all the concession here. And he did know about impending chemical attack at Duma. Yet he bears responsibility for all these things because of the agents he chose. What he wanted was the possibility of denial, and what he got was the impossibility of control. So this means these things will be happening again and again, up to a real conventional war, which is possible. And possibly the last thing I'll try to say, yes. And it's that Putin is shifting his social base. Up until recently, he was more or less, his base was more or less Russian elite. It was an average Russian official who was taking bribes, paying lip service to patriotic slogans, and his property, children, and money were in the West. Now, this average patriotic official realizes that his money isn't safe anymore, and if he stays in the West, it will be impounded. If it goes back to Russia, it can any minute be confiscated. Куда ни кинь, всюду клин, as we say in Russia. Everywhere there is a trouble, and the one responsible for it is Mr. Putin. So, actually, his base, Putin is shifting his base towards general population, towards poor guys, and actually the poorer the better. Because, you know, a rich guy, he's thinking about his freedom, and a poor guy, on average, he just wants a leader to follow, and he wants his poverty to have some high cause. The more poor the Russian population will get, the more addicted it will be to Putin and to confrontation with the West. Actually, that's the last thing I want to say, because a rich guy, he wants freedom, and a poor guy wants his poverty to have a meaning. And this makes Putin internally actually absolutely invulnerable, because the worse it will get, the more patriotic it will become. And actually, probably the last thing is that patriotism right now and confrontation with the West is to average Russian what a promise to eternal life was for a Christian slave in Rome. Yes, you're suffering, but all this is for a higher cause.